directly speak with hardware in some way or another. So a philosophy is a bit different to what we know about small talk. So my philosophy when I was designing that project is that all interesting stuff should happen at language side. We don't want to go to the to use another tool to go to the C, to go to deal with the C compiler and to actually split our development process on different stages. But in Smalltalk you have you accept new changes and they are already there, they are already working. But in C you save in the files, they compile and restart your program, and this is completely different cycle. So I wanted to make it easier for low level stuff to make it work same the same way as we usually do in Smalltalk. You accept in the change and it works. Another aspect of it is that you should be able to deliver your products or deliver your project purely in Smalltalk code without need to accompany your to package everything with additional DLLs and of course the DLL means that you need to separately build it for separate platforms and so on, so on. So there's a lot of complexity around making this sure that your code works on all platforms and it can be accessed over all existing implementations. So the philosophy is like that. And the only conclusion which if you look this at as a requirement is that VM plugin should be essentially small and contain no complex logic, because all interesting stuff should happen in the image side. And what actually plugin does, if you strip over the details, is just retrieves the pointer to the meshing code and then just doing a call. So this is as simple as that. The rest of logic, like what is the contracts with VM and how you should do that and in what way, what are connection with VM, what protocols you have support, what object formats, all this logic is in the image side. And what code to generate. So 2 years ago, I proposed to extend the compiled method trailer in Scrip to contain not only the, so originally it was containing only 4 bytes which point into the source of the method of compiled method, and I proposed to extend the compiled method trailer to carry more information and actually contain the arbitrary information which can be used for things like that. And then, so this is a logical step to create a different kind of trailer which says that this trailer contains not only the pointer to source code of method, but it also contains the meshing code. And like that, so native code is embedded in the body in the compiler. So, and this means that, for instance, comparing to JIT, when you have a separate for the native code, which lives outside of object memory, it means that we need to separately manage that code zone, and when compiled method is going to die, you have to free the memory and so on, so on. Well, this is quite cheap and simple. So you have everything in the object, and once object is no longer used, it becomes garbage, and so your native code as well. So this is why when you change the method, it works like same as for the rest of method. When you change the method, it changes, installs new method into the class, and old method becomes garbage, and means that new implementation will be available once you accept it. No extra complexity in the implementation, and everything is handled by GCS for the rest of objects. This however requires that object memory should be placed in the executable memory region. And this is the only change. Yes, so all native code is invoked via a single primitive, which is called primitive native call, and from native boost plugin. So the components of the project, ASM.JIT is a port from the corresponding C project, open source project. So I took the instruction database for x86, x64 instruction set, and just ported the instruction database and simply made a wrapper, a nice wrapper which forms kind of Smalltalk DSA for assembler. So you can write the assembler code in Smalltalk with ease. And you can, this project actually could be seen as separate and as most low level assembler, low level part of the project, and it could be used by not just by a native boost, it could be used for something else, like if you want to experiment with JIT implementation, or if you want to generate native code for any other purpose. So it is there. You can use it separately without even using native. So then another part is the core, which contains the core implementation of the language side, and parts which contain the glue code for bootstrapping native boost for specific platforms. And of course, there's tests and examples. So ASM.JIT is, in a nutshell, as I said, it is more, but if you're familiar with assembler, so it looks like just an assembler but written in Smalltalk syntax. So you have the you start from instruction mnemonic, and then you pass in the operands. So push EBP is pushing the register stack and things like that. So there is no for people who know what is assembler, this quite natural and quite simple to use. And I can show you what it produces.
Absolute addresses in a binary which moves around.
How do you what?
a call interruption in which the 386 has an absolute address.
Yeah,
the library is moving around in the garbage collector.
I will talk about
that. Okay, sorry.
So, yes. So there's support for labels and jumps, so you could have the relative jumps, which easily, I mean, if you once in your life met with assembler, you will probably know how to use it here. So let's continue. So the native boost contains from multiple parts. The top level interface is native boost class, which contains the logic mostly for bootstrapping the native boost and allowing you to deal with platform specific stuff like memory allocation. This is the most stuff which is used by most of the projects. I mean, independently what you're going to do, you're likely to be allocating external memory, you're likely to have some access to the virtual machine interface and so on. So this class is like a base class for interacting with the rest of the facilities. Then another facility is a interpreter proxy. It's a reification of the virtual machine IP. So it's complete in Squeak virtual machine. There is a formal IP which contains a list of functions which you can use in your plugins to talk with VM, to extract the data from objects, to manipulate the stack, and so on, so on. So this class provides the same interface which you can use in generated code to talk with VM, and actually it allows you to write primitives in same way as you write in them in C using this protocol. And then of course there's FFI callout interface, a different set of types is for marshaling arguments and converting return values. And there is an interface for generating native functions and placing them in the heap. So if you want a persistent function, I mean, you're not only limited to generate the code and put it into the method. You can actually generate the code and put it into the external memory. So you can use this function from as callback in another function or reuse it later. I mean, there is no any limits about that. Yes, and there is a callbacks. Unfortunately, initially I was developed the native boost in Squeak VM, but then Coq came and it has different structure and different implementations slightly. So callbacks not working yet in the Coq VM, but they work well in the Squeak VM. So give it a time, we will have everything there. Yes, native boost interface. So as I said, it contains a code for bootstrapping, for memory, for basic memory management. So you can allocate and deallocate the external memory blocks, which are outside of the object memory. It also provides a basic. It also provides a basic interface for loading external libraries and binding and look up the symbols in them. So it is platform specific, and that's why native boost serves as a facade for all this stuff. And yes, that's why we have multiple subclasses there to serve platform specific needs. The interpreter proxy, as I said, it's just a table function with some helper methods. It's I also started to extend it with a object format. So actually, some of the methods could be short. You could do a short tree without actually calling the interpreter proxy function, because if you know what object format you're running on VM, you could do much simpler operations and you can do more optimizations. So this class serves as a generic interface for interacting with virtual machines. And also about the calls. So some of the virtual machine function could trigger garbage collection. And the problem is that when your native code is located in compiled method, the compiled method can be moved in the memory. And it means that you made a call inside this native code. And when then it goes to the virtual machine, it's doing the garbage collection and moves that code. And then it wants to return, but the return location is different. It must be adjusted because the native code is moved. For this, there is a limitation that native code which you place in the method, it should be location agnostic. So it should be positional and independent code. And the second limitation that you should call those functions using special gate function. It just captures the return address and then automatically patching it once you return from the patch. So it's mostly you don't see it. I mean, you just do the simple call and then the interpreter proxy handling this under the hood. So you don't need to know that there is some specific. I mean, the only limitation that you should not use the relative calls. You should always use absolute addresses for your code. So that's the only limitation. Because if code moves, then you have to adjust all this stuff. And if your code is positional independent, then you don't need to do it because code remains safe. Yes.
That also means that you cannot allocate new object memory while in the function, because then the function itself might move while it's being executed.
You can allocate.
But what happens if a scavenge happens while it's being executed?
So you can so the marshalling code. So when you're returning the for instance, when you forming a having some result to return from the external call, and you want to create an object for the result, like float or some structure, you have to create this object, right? So you're making a call to virtual machine and asking it to allocate new object, and then you're storing this some data there in that object. I mean, and when you ask VM to allocate new object, it automatically means that it might trigger a GC.
No, I mean, if you are in a this code,
yes.
And you call a function from that one, and this function, which you called from this dynamically generated code,
yes.
Initiates a garbage collection.
Yes, it may initiate.
It may do that. Then you go back through the gate. Then you relocate the return address, is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, once this function returns, it's actually... So there is a resident function which called call gate function. So you you actually not call them directly the VM function, but you call them the Colgate, and Colgate handling this return address adjustment. So FFI callout is a class for generating the code for foreign function interface. So initially I was thinking that when I was made the first few things, like being able to generate the code, being able to interact with the internet, what is the next step? And then I just for fun tried to implement the same functionality which TQEM has for foreign function interface. And it turned out that it's quite useful, not only just for the calling the external functions themselves, but even for implementing a primitive. Because, for example, for example, if you want to accept only float objects, you could actually tell that here I want the double time, and the FFI callout machinery automatically generates the code to check that you pass in the right argument and converting it to double. So then all you need to do is to load the double value and do something with it. So you don't have to do a lot of stuff, a lot of checks manually. So this is quite useful. And of course, I will speak a bit more about this in following slides. So let's demonstrate the first foreign call, which I just took the one of the simplest functions in the standard C library. It's getting the environment variable value by name. So how to do that in Native Boost? There is already an implementation, but I want to do that from scratch. So firstly, we want to tell VM that it invoked via primitive. So I always include the primitive. Actually copying the function definition from documentation to our code and saying that it is located in C in module C library. Yes, the one thing that it cannot find the name because the name argument cannot be resolved, so this is a mistake which I made. So I have to change the code. Yeah, and so the answer is nil because there is no such environment variable. So let's try the home. Also new. That's the problem. We should see that the function actually uses the char pointers, but it's hard to tell when char pointer could be anything. Of course, in most cases in C you use a char pointer as a pointer to move terminate the string, but NativeBoost has no any clues. Maybe this is actually a pointer to something. So for that there is a special type which called string, which deals with no terminated string. So we replace in the char pointer type with a string. And then we have this word. If you want to use some C library functions, it should be already there because virtual machine links to the C library, and you don't need to tell the path like user bin leave blah blah blah.
Okay, if I want to call library X, what do I need to do?
Library X?
Some library.
So you just tell in that. You just put in the library name here, like user lib
or full path,
whatever. It depends. So originally the NativeBoost follows the same semantics of library lookup as in a virtual machine. But you can change this. Actually this method, the cdecl module, so you could actually pass there not the library name but library handle. And the way how you obtain it, it's not limited. I mean you could use your own pass your own location for the library, and you know how to open it, and then you just pass in the module handle. So you can actually customize the, in contrast to the FFI, which is plugin in the virtual machine, you can customize the library lookup mechanism. Yes, so this is an example which we did. So what is the magic behind this? As you see the code here, it's actually a small top code except that you have the primitive, right? So when you first time invoking this method, a primitive fails because there is no native code installed in the method, and then it enters the method body. The FFI callout checks, doing some checks, and then it actually figures out that the method in the question has no native code, and it actually generates the native code, installs this code into the method and retries the message sent, which means that you don't need to do some save, compile, run like in C. You just accept the method, and next time it will be invoked, it will use a new version. Yes, and what is good that lifecycle of your code is the same as the lifecycle of the method. So once you change the method, you change, you throw away the old implementation, and you got different results. And of course, a great power comes with his big responsibility. So, but so some details about forming the code. So you see the legend. So you have the method, you have the arguments, and then you use the NBFFI callout. The first keyboard is for the calling convention. So there is currently two calling conventions which I implemented, the CDECL and the STDCALL, which I used mostly on Windows. It's a bit different calling convention. And then you inside of the first argument, you pass in the array, which is a function definition. In most cases, you don't need to do some voodoo dance. You just copy the function definition from documentation, paste it here, and then you specify which model, what model needs to be used to look up the given function, which is a get n, where to look up it, where to look up for the address of the function. So that's quite easy, I think. So for instance, there is another, this is Windows specific. So this is a Windows kernel function, which is a heap alloc. And the point is that here you have three arguments. And actually, what is useful, once you have an initialized heap, you only need to pass only bytes. The rest two arguments are actually not changed, because you created a new heap and you allocate some memory in this heap object. And you know that the flux will be always the same, so if you always want to zero memory, you pass the 8 as the second argument, or if you want to generate exceptions when this memory region, when allocation fails, you pass this appropriate one. So naively, you just create the same the method with same signature, so you have all the three arguments, heap, flux, and number of bytes, and then you pass in all those arguments. And then the drawback of this is that if you want a shortcut like allocate, so you make another call to this method. And this method actually becomes a private part of your framework, because you don't want to expose this method to the users. You want actually to expose the allocate, because it's easier and more natural. You don't want to user to know that there is some handle of the heap hidden somewhere. So you want users to use the allocate. So you have to do this like that. This is naively. And clever approach is that you actually can pass the constants and special types inside the function signature. So if you see here that I pass in the self as a kind of pseudo argument and zero as constant, it means that the generated code for this callout will load the handle from some instance variable from somewhere from the receiver and simply push the zero as a second argument, and then only for the number of bytes, which is useful for our API function, it will be extracted from the method arguments. So the rest is hidden from users. And same with zero allocates, you only change the constant to the call. And of course this also makes your calls faster, because if you look here, that every time you pass in some, because the generated code, it don't knows what you passed actually. If you could pass any kind of object to the method, so it has to do the checks like, okay, flux should be integer, I should check that the incoming object are integer and do conversion from the small node to the seed type and so on. Well, in this case, there is no any check, it's just pushing the constant of the stack, right? Yes?
So how do you know there in that declaration that the zero is a D-word?
How do I know?
Yeah, when you're generating native code, you need to know that the zero is supposed to be a D-word, right? Where is the declaration coming?
Yes, this is because according to calling convention, all arguments are 32-bit.
Okay.
So you actually don't need to care a lot about that.
Okay.
Yes, but of course, if there will be some cases where you need to care, you could annotate the type there. So. If it's in some future you will have calling convention which will require that, so that's not a problem. Yes. So the type system is written completely in Smalltalk, and it serves to marshal the objects to the C types. So there is support for basic types like integers, floats, bytes, words, and pointers. And then there's support for type aliases and support for the C structures, which is represented by NB external structure class. So it's mostly originally, if you're familiar with Squeak FFI interface, it's mostly the same, except that there is a couple of quite powerful extensions that you can use type aliasing, and you can use the constants, and you can actually use the for passing the arguments. You're not limited to pass only arguments which are method arguments. You can pass the receiver itself, you can pass the receiver's instance variables, and so on. Yes. So the custom types, you can always implement own custom type. So it of course means that you need to deal with some assembly code, but it works that. So here the example. The problem is that, for instance, in Squeak, you have two kinds of strings. One is a byte string, and another is byte string, which are sequence of Unicode characters. But there is no strings which encoded in UTF-8. Mm-hmm. And imagine that you have the function which actually expects that you pass the UTF-8 string. And this type actually takes the byte string of Squeak or Faro, the byte string, and on the fly converts it to UTF-8 representation, then pushing it on the stack. So if you know how to convert the Unicode value to the UTF-8, yeah, so there is a, it's quite simple code, but it is more, yes, it is elaborate, because there's all this operations is a separate assembler instruction. So
you have a simulation to debug that?
No. So it's good. So here we have the function, the method which uses type. So it takes the MBUGF8 string example, which is our custom type, and takes the Y string as argument. And then you see this a trick that I'm not using I'm not going to call any specific function like from foreign model. I'm just saying that to emit call I use this instruction. It means that FFI callout actually prepares all arguments for me and pushes them on stack, and then here I can write an arbitrary assembly code. So actually what I do is just copying the last value which pushed on stack, and it's going to be returned to the language back. So I'm converting the string, a byte string, to the string, and it should be a UTF-8 encoded. So let's see. Encode to UTF-8. So, of course, for the basic ASCII characters, you have no difference. So let's try to...
character as string.
Yeah. I really wonder why we cannot concatenate characters. So you see there's a little of garbage. So actually the three extra characters. And if you convert this to the byte array, you could see the last three bytes is actually an encode, the character 3567 encoded in UTF-8. So. Yes, some examples which I'd like to show you. Yeah, let's see this one. This is quite simple one. So that all objects in the object format, you have the, for all objects in memory, you have the object header. And sometimes you will be curious what are the actual value of the object header, and you cannot do that in Smalltalk because the object header is hidden from your eyes. So let's first try to... So it returns some value. And then we here have the implementation, which again use the trick that here I want to return the unsigned integer value, and pushing the self as OOP type. It means that the type conversion, there is no any type conversion done, it's just pushing the receiver once on the stack. And then the retrieving the code to retrieve the object header is simple. You pop in the last value on stack, which is to be received, then you check it that it is integer object, because integer objects has no headers, because it's immediate objects, right? So either you return zero, or you return the header, which is a on script VMs is a first word which you read from the object pointer. Another example which I did a year ago is some guys are complaining that getting the hash value of the byte stream is quite slow because it's implemented in the Smalltalk, while you can actually implement it in the as primitive. So instead of implementing it in implementing a new primitive and delivering a new VMs with a new primitive, you could actually quickly implement it with native. So there is a NVHash, and the actual implementation is a hash somewhere. So just let me demonstrate. You have the byte stream hash. Same value, but what we actually wondering about, how about performance? So I take the, I will generate some bit stream for that. The tricky part with those benchmarks is that if you don't put too much load on the primitive itself, you will actually see the difference. It's quite small because you mentioned the loop by itself. Because if you put the low payload into the loop, most of the cycles are spent in loop instead of doing some workload. So I have to put some stream, so a big stream. What did I do wrong? Maybe it's too big stream.
All right. While that's running, we're also running out of time. So, any questions?
So here the difference in performance is more than 10 times.
Okay.
So, as I understood that your concern is that not all the operating systems has some security policies around whether allow application to make some regions executable or not.
No, you're allowed to make regions executable, or you're allowed to make them writable. But on a modern system, you're not allowed to make them both.
To dynamically make executable, right?
You can make it executable, or you can make it writable. You can make it writable and then executable, but not writable and executable.
No,
at the same time. This is pretty standard now on modern operating systems.
It works quite simple. I mean, if you just read the documentation, so you can write, you can set the flux for your heap, so you can for almost kernel functions which allow you to allocate virtual memory, you can set the writable and executable and readable or any sort of.
You'll get an exception on a modern system.
Well, if you have an exception, then yeah, you have to do some workarounds.
All right.
What choice do we have? I mean, some operating systems don't even allow you to run don't allow you to dynamically generate code into JIT code.
So you just have to separate it out. You have to have the code external, and then you can change the bits to make it writable, change the bits back to make it external, but not at the same time. That's
yes.
All right. So let's take this offline. Thank you.